This is Whitley Strieber, and this is Dreamland. You've reached the edge of the world.
Well, today on this Dreamland special, we're talking to William Galison about the mummies that are in Peru. He has been working with Theirry, Jamin, a French adventurer and explorer who is living in Peru and who first brought the mummies to the attention of the world. And this situation that has occurred in Mexico in the past few days needs a little bit more depth to it, because there is a difference between what is going on in Peru and what exists in Peru and what was talked about in Mexico, a significant difference. And it's an important one. You know, I think the way to begin is to talk a little bit about what was shown in Mexico. And there's some problems with this material. You sent me a paper that discusses some of the problems. Can you tell me a little bit about that?
Well, this is very interesting. And I'm learning new things every day, Whitley, about this stuff. And my estimation of the situation is evolving on an hourly basis. I've been involved with the situation since pretty much Theirry divulged the existence of these things in 2016. I went down with Bob Salas in 2018. We went and we saw the mummies at that point. At this point, those mummies are being kept at the Ica University in Nazca, near Nazca, Peru, in Ica, actually.
So that's entirely legal and above board, is what you're saying.
All that stuff has been resolved with the Peruvian government through the efforts of Theirry, really, the very...
How did mummies end up in Mexico? I should say, folks, wait a minute. It's illegal to export these.
It is absolutely illegal. And as far as I know, these mummies were represented by Jaime as being among the mummies found in Peru. And that does raise an interesting question of how could Jaime have those mummies, which are patrimony of Peru, in Mexico when they are in fact illegal to remove from Peru. So
and
the question
on
is,
television in front of the whole Mexican Congress, that seems, I mean, it almost makes me think they aren't really from Peru.
Well, it wouldn't be the Mexican authorities that would be concerned with them. It would be the Peruvian authorities. And I don't think they're going to have Jaime Maussan extradited for having them, but he might be in trouble if he went to Peru, I suppose. If in fact those were original mummies of the type that Theirry was offered and shown by the tomb robber Mario, the Jaquero Mario, who's the one who ostensibly was discovered these things. Now, Mario gave some to Theirry, and as far as I know, those are the only ones extant. But according to Jaime, he has at least two, which he has now demonstrated to the Mexican Congress. So that is a bit of a mystery. Are these reproductions? Are they real? They look real to me, but that's just an eyeball.
I have been trying, and you have been trying, to get some serious scientific interest in this. And there has been some scientific work done on these mummies. And it's perfectly good work. There's nothing wrong with it. But we need more. But let's talk now about what has been done so far. And can you line up for us? There's been carbon dating. There has been some DNA analysis. Tell us what's been done.
That's right. I should mention that. In case people are confused, it is illegal to take the mummies out of Peru, but apparently the Peruvian government does not object to taking a sample of tissue to be analyzed in Sri Lanka or Canada or Puerto Rico or any of the other places where they either DNA testing has been done or carbon-14 dating. And I will say that the carbon-14 dating, to me, is very conclusive because it was... these, as your listeners probably know, there are two types of mummy.
Right. Let's explain that, because that's really unclear.
There are, and when I say mummy, we're just using that as a descriptor. Whether they're real mummies or what the definition of a mummy is another question. But there are two kinds of creatures, if you will, or bodies that we're looking at. One of them, one type, are what we call they call them the small grays, and I hate to use the word gray, so let's just call them the small bodies. And they are about 2.5 feet tall. There are many of them. I've seen a dozen different ones. Apparently, I've heard that there's at least 25 or 30 of these, and then even more loose skulls, meaning the skulls of these creatures without the entire body. These beings, as I said, are about 2.5 feet tall. They resemble kind of the aliens that we think of being gray, insofar as they have proportionately large heads. They all have three fingers and three toes, which is why, as a group, they're all called the tridactyl mummies. Tridactyl meaning three digits on each appendage. That is the first category, and there, as I said, there are numerous examples of those. And then there is one example, although there's good indication that there are more examples, but there's at least one which is known, which is called Maria. Maria is probably the most famous of these mummies, and they say she could be a male or a female. This is a body that was found, according to Mario, in the same location as the small bodies, but this one would be about 5'7" if standing up. In fact, this body is in a kind of fetal position, if you will, in the burial position that was typical of the Incan mummies, or the mummies of South America. It actually predates the Incans, because this one has been dated to 2000 years old, or about 1800 years ago, before the Incan civilization existed. It was what was called the Nazca culture, and it was actually around the time that the mysterious Nazca lines were produced, however they were produced. So that is interesting.
The Nazca lines look like something that's meant to be seen from above.
Well, there's many, many mysteries regarding the Nazca lines, how they were done, why they were done, and by whom were they done particularly. So
that mystery's just been deepened a good bit, hasn't it?
Yes, indeed. And so this larger mummy, which we'll call Maria, that's what she's been named. This is what I understand. I'm not a person who has done measurements and testing myself, but I've been very intimately involved with the people who have done them. My understanding, she is about human size, 5'7", if you will, if she were standing up. Of course, she's desiccated and cannot be stretched out to her full length, but it can be determined that she would be about 5'7". Interesting thing, if you look at her head, she is certainly not a typical looking person. The head is very well preserved. And if you saw this person walking down the street, whether it's a man or a woman, that would be a remarkable looking person. She has a very large jaw. She has a tiny nose, which is not typical of what we imagine Indians looking like in South America. And she has an extended cranium, not as big as what they call the Paracas mummies, or some of the Egyptian depictions of extended crania, but definitely my understanding from the measurements that have been made, and I trust them, is that her cranial capacity, which corresponds to the size of the brain, is 20% larger than a typical human brain. Now, human brains come in different sizes, but I believe this 20% is larger than the media of human brains. And if you think about it, I don't know, but 20% larger brain, is a very stunning capacity. I don't know how much larger our brains are than, let's say, a great ape, but it may be within that range. So there could be a difference in cognition between this creature and us. I'm just speculating. That seems to be the fact, though, that if you that the cranial capacity, meaning the brain case of this Maria, is larger than a human. The eye sockets also were measured to be about 20% larger than a human. Again, these are the figures that I have heard from scientists whose opinions and research I have no reason to doubt. So
now, let me ask
now
you,
but the main difference between Maria and you and me is that she has three fingers on her each hand and three toes on each foot. And not only that, the fingers that she does have an extra digit where we have four phalanges, one being in the hand and then three being visible in our fingers. She has an extra one. That's very unusual. It's never been seen in any human genetic defect, for example, or genetic anomaly. The question is that everybody wants to know is, are these variations natural? The skull certainly could not be manipulated. I want to just say that people will say, oh, yes, but people have their skulls bound in many cultures. Binding of the skull does not affect the cranial capacity of the skull. It simply shapes the skull differently so that it starts, the forehead is more sloped and the cranium goes back further. That's different from this case, in my understanding, where the cranial capacity is actually larger. So it doesn't seem like a result of binding. There's also, it doesn't look like it's been bound. There are no flat areas, for example, which is very often a result of that kind of binding. So that said, the next question is, are the three fingers with the extra joint natural, or have they been fabricated in some way? Did someone get into this mummy and add an extra joint? And that is something that we have to explore. We have to definitively determine whether that is a natural configuration or whether, as some people say, a joint was added to the fingers, and two fingers, the being the thumb and the pinky, were removed, leaving three out of the normal five. I find it difficult to imagine how that could be done without obvious manipulation, and but there are those that question that.
Well, the reason they question it is that this is just so incredibly unusual and unexpected, and they're, you know, they're perhaps the questioning is in the wrong direction to some extent. Now, I would like to sort of add a couple of things. First, there was a piece published on Reddit that goes into the biology of the ones that the U.S. government has possession of, the bodies. And it mentions, I don't honestly know whether that Reddit is accurate or not. From things I've heard over the years, it's quite accurate. But I don't have any other documentation.
I've seen that. It was purportedly from a whistleblower. Yeah.
Right, right. And but it mentions, and this is very important, that the brains have four lobes. We have three lobes in our brain. And this fourth lobe would increase the size of the cranium by about 20%. And it's terribly important because it's, I think that in order to, this is now a little bit off our subject, and I'll go right back to our subject in just a moment. To understand all of this, we're going to have to understand what that fourth lobe does if we're going to understand our relationship with these entities. Now, the other thing is this, and this is a personal observation. Remember, I had lots of personal observation of such an individual. And that was the communion lady. She had, her fingers were like this, But they were snake-like. She could manipulate them. They almost looked like snakes. And once when there was a child at the cabin that she did not like because he had disfigured himself by sticking his tongue in a light bulb socket when he was 4 years old. Now he was 11 or 12. And she didn't want our boy to be anywhere near him. And she spent the night. She used to spend time in the cabin. And I haven't talked about that much because it's impossible to, people would just disbelieve it. But there, it's a little less like that now. So I'm talking a little bit more. When you looked at her, first of all, it was like looking at a really strange looking person with great mm-hmm. big eyes.
Right.
But anyway, this boy was there and they were sleeping in the boy's room and she kept coming up to my bedside and putting things in my head of our son being captured by a bad cab driver, being abducted while he was going to the boy's house, and all these things. And she would make what looked like smoke pour out of her mouth. And she was communicating that she did not think this boy was the right choice as a friend.
Okay.
When she wasn't with us, as it turned out, she was going to the boy's room, opening the door a crack and sticking three of those long, sneaky fingers in and tapping the door with her fingernails and scraping up and down. The little boy, the guest, was sleeping right across from the door. Our son was on the other side of the room, so he didn't see this. The boy was, the next morning, he was terrified. He said that this thing had been doing this to him all night. He hadn't gotten any sleep. And then he said, "Mr. Strieber, would you please take me home?"
I did.
And that ended the friendship. That the boys never saw each other again. Let's go back to where we were.
Right.
What I'm saying here is two things. One, that are corroborating. One is there is probably an explanation for the larger head. And two is I have witnessed myself, a living person who looked like that, very much like your like Maria.
Okay, I don't know what you saw, so I imagine that's exactly what you, I trust you on that. I will say that I mean it's interesting when you say that she had three fingers and they were snake-like. I think it's hard for us to imagine what it looks like to have an extra joint on a hand. So possibly that would certainly make it look far more flexible and snake-like than a three or four. Or a three-digit finger, to have a fourth digit on the finger would certainly make an impression. I think it could look snake-like. So there could be a correlation there. Again, we don't know if Maria is related to other species of visitors or whatever. But given that, but that's a very interesting correlation and quite astonishing that your creature had three fingers as well. As far as the lobes of the brain,
I think it was three. Yeah,
I think I'm pretty sure that the shape of the brain with the CAT scans, if it had something as remarkable as a fourth lobe, I think that would have been evident. My feeling is that this was just a larger human-like brain.
Okay.
But again, I'm no expert, but that's an interesting thing to explore. But if I can get back to the presentation in Mexico, which is kind of our focus,
right?
They did not discuss the Maria type. I'm just throwing that in there to make sure people understand that there are two species that we're discussing here. Jaime Masson did not present anything to do with the Maria type. Very possibly because he doesn't have one of those. He apparently has two of the smaller types, and they look very much like the ones I saw. However, I would say that when I saw the photographs of the one in Mexico, they have much more of what looks like a nose than I have ever seen in the mummies that I have seen in photographs and also seen very up close and spent a lot of time with. They do not have what you would call a nose. And from the photos I saw, From the Mexico presentation, they seem to have more of a nose. So are they a different lot? Are they somebody's idea of a fake? I mean, are they some artist's elaboration?
It occurs to me that they were outside of Peru because they have been made in Mexico.
That's a possibility. That would be awfully gutsy of Jaime Masson, but he's not known for shyness, I think. But anyway, that aside, that's all speculation. I do want to mention something very important, which has come to my attention in the last day, amazingly enough. There was an article in the New York Times yesterday or the day before regarding the presentation of these mummies in Mexico City. And it wasn't as dismissive as one might think. The headline was Alien Mummies from Outer Space or something like that, which is unnecessarily dismissive, I think. But the body of it talked about the presentation and mentioned at the bottom of the article that these mummies, the ones found in Peru, had been established that their skulls were made from modified llama skulls. And we should take that very seriously.
I think so too. I saw that, you know, and I saw the paper
we both have looked at the paper now. That paper, by the way, is co-authored by Jose de la Cruz. Jose de la Cruz was one of the first people who started analyzing the mummies with Thierry Jamin. Back in 2016, he did a lot of good work. And he was one of three. Now, he does not speak English, and the paper was in English, so I don't know what his contribution was or whether it was written in Spanish. It was, in fact, published in a Greek scientific journal, and perhaps you can put a link to that
Yes, I will, folks. There will be a link.
It's very important that people look at that, because that is the most inclusive scientific treatment of this case that I have seen so far. It actually takes a llama skull and compares it bone by bone, square centimeter by square centimeter feature by feature to the mummy skull.
In other words, the small mummies are not real.
Well, according to this paper, and I must say, and I've been an advocate of the reality of these things for years, because of the limited information that I've had and my enthusiasm for this subject. But I'm not afraid to go where the evidence brings me. And I was quite convinced by this paper. As a non-scientist, it seems like a sober, responsible and accurate scientific paper that concludes, and there's some subtlety here, that these alien skulls, that these so-called small alien skulls, they are not like they took the head of a llama and put it on a body. In fact, it's the brain case of a llama skull, which has been turned around. The jaw and many other sections of the actual skull have been removed from the skull. This was very carefully done. And the back of the llama skull is, in fact, what we see as the face of the mummy skull, which was somebody's brilliant idea that the back of a llama skull would resemble a hominid face, but in fact, it does. However, I don't want to, even the article, which concludes this is probably a llama skull, which has been manipulated in certain ways, even that says there are some notable differences between the mummies, the skull of the mummies, and the ancient llama skulls that they had to used as reference. But these are fairly subtle differences. And they say that it could be differences between individuals. In other words, the kind of things that make my skull would make my skull look different from your skull. But they're quite convinced that, in fact, what serves as the skull on these small mummies is derived from a llama skull. Now, the first inclination is to say, okay, that solves it. End of conversation. That's the end of the story. However, it gets more complicated than that.
I'll say it does. Go on.
For one thing, there is a bone in which serves as a kind of jaw on these small skulls, which is set into what is an aperture in what would be the back of the llama skull, if you follow me. And this jaw is kind of hinged, and they say they don't know what kind of animal this from. And if, in fact, they can find with higher quality scans that there's an actual organic link between this jaw and the skull, then perhaps this is some bizarre coincidence or paranormal
situation. Yeah, but it's where, any of this
but
stuff.
Certainly to me, the idea that there could be some kind of convergent evolution that would form two complex bone structures, one being a llama skull and the other being an alien skull, and it seems completely beyond the pale. And that's what these scientists have discovered. They want higher resolution scans. Now, in fact, and I can't go into it, but we did some higher resolution scans when I was in Peru in my last trip, which was not long ago. Very high resolution. Where
not of these particular mummies.
Not of that particular mummy, but of one that is definitely in the same family. And that's as far as I'm going to talk about.
Okay, but hopefully it'll be studied.
Oh, well, it's available. I paid for that CT scan.
Yeah.
So as far as anybody is concerned, I can give those CT scans. And I'm talking about this gigantic, enormous file, which can be looked at by anybody who cares to look at it. And I will give it to them with no conditions whatsoever. Hopefully they will analyze it in an honest manner and, you know, without prejudice. And they can see, perhaps, at that point, what the relation is between this flap that serves as a jaw and are they organically mated, or is it taken from God only knows what other animal and stuck in that place?
Yeah.
Whatever you want to say about these things, and even if they are entirely fabricated from other organic material, including a llama skull, somebody put a tremendous amount of thought and cleverness into making these things. And the researchers in this paper say they find it hard to imagine how artisans from 1,000 years ago could have constructed these things.
Now this, folks, this is something that's kind of crept up on my audience. We know that these things, even though they are apparently at the moment seem to be fabrications, are also 1,000 years old.
The material in them is 1,000 years old. So far,
whoever did this, if they did it recently, they were careful to find material that old.
Right. They were not using llama skulls that they found in a llama cemetery. Now, did they happen upon an ancient graveyard where mummified llama bones were kept? I guess that's possible. According to this scientific paper, and these people spent a lot of time, and I know Jose de la Cruz has spent countless hours with these mummies, he sees no indication that these are modern frauds. Now, the word fraud indicates an intent to deceive.
Yes.
If these are ritualistic dolls, if you will, or ritualistic figures, which represent the relation of llamas and humans, God only knows, from 1,000 years old, this opens up very rich archaeological and anthropological ground. And so far, nobody has established, as far as I know, certainly nobody's published, that any indication has been given that these are modern frauds. Now, I just want to expand on that. These are not just skulls. There are more skulls than bodies, but there are lots of bodies, and those bodies include arm bones, leg bones, finger bones, pelvis, ribs, all the analogous bones to a human body, basically, except that the forearms and the lower limbs of the legs have one bone instead of two. But where are those bones from? The conjecture, my conjecture is, and some other people who doubt that these are alien bodies say that they must be human bones because they don't seem to correspond with any other animal. And since these things are two feet tall, they must be infant bones. These are not, I mean, a human pelvis on one of these 2 foot things would be bizarre looking.
We would be able to determine all of this.
With the CT scans, even at the low resolution, you can isolate every bone in the body and view it and turn it 3D. This is one of the things that confused me and kind of kept me with the impression that these were authentically anomalous beings, was that I thought, well, certainly somebody must have just done that and taken somebody who knows the human anatomy and the anatomy of an infant or even a, and said, okay, this is the hips. This is the pelvic girdle or the ribs, or the sternum or the arms of a infant human being. As far as I know, nobody has established that yet. And I don't know why, Whitley, but here's the good news. And this is something that I'm telling you now for the first time. I got a call after we spoke yesterday from a fellow, I won't mention his name, but he is a TV producer and he's worked with a lot of people that you and I know in this field. He's not associated with Gaia. He's not associated with Masson. He's associated with people that we respect. And he called me because he heard me. He happened to see me write a message to Jimmy Church on a podcast. And he called me and he knew that I was friendly with Theirry. And he said that he thinks he can find a sponsor, a patron, to pay for tests which will establish once and for all what are these things made of and when were they made.
The small mummies.
That's all we're discussing right now.
Right.
This will take some money, but not enormous money.
No.
We're talking, you know, $100,000 might be able to settle every question we have. What are those questions? First of all, rather than comparing the morphology of a llama skull and a human skull, simply take a DNA from the skull of one of these humanoid small beings and do DNA testing on it.
That's definitely where to go, because this is so, I've been following you guys and your journey through this labyrinth of mirrors for a long time, and certainly long enough to know that in this particular labyrinth, there's no such thing as a door that leads out. It just leads deeper into the labyrinth. But that's the way to go, to just, you know, to cut the Gordian knot by going to the DNA. Absolutely.
Now, DNA tests have been done. And again, that was part of the reason that I held on to my conviction that these were authentic.
Now, were these DNA tests done on the little ones or on a large?
They were done on both.
Ah.
And according to the DNA results that carry the imprimatur, if that's the word, of the labs where they were done, and they are listed on the website which Theirry has put up called The Alien Project. I should add that Theirry Jamin is as honest a person as I know, and he is not in any way trying to trick anybody with these things.
Yeah.
So anybody thinks that he's a hoaxer or trying to make money, he's made not a penny from this, and he's put hours and precious money of his own. And I have too. Yes, I have.
Yeah. Others have as well. There's other people who've put some money into it, but the key is that the money you guys have put into it has been well spent, because it's produced DNA testing and all kinds of things.
Now, when I see someone like Jaime presenting these things, and they look a little suspect, and how did he get them out of Peru, and blah blah blah, I begin to question whether there's an unbroken line of information from the lab to Theirry, for example. I mean, I would think that it would be impossible for anybody to get a result from a lab, publish that result, and if it was not what the lab meant to say or what the lab intended the result to be, that would be accepted by the lab. But on the other hand, maybe the lab hasn't been paying attention. I don't know personally what the chain of custody is. And it's not only DNA data, it's the interpretation of the DNA data. I know there are honest people who have spent time analyzing that data, but I think this has to be done in-house, if you will. That is, with people that we trust and we know from the beginning of the process. Now, if this producer finds a patron and he believes he has one in mind, what they would do is that they would go to ICA or wherever these mummies are currently being held. They would get samples, film that
process.
That process of getting the DNA so that nobody can deny that this is a valid, you know, because it's not simple. Where do you get the DNA? How do you get it? Do you get it from the skull? Do you get it from the hip? Hey, if the hip is from a different animal than the skull, then you're going
to,
then
you need to get it from both. Yeah.
To get it from as many places.
You have to have a variety of samples.
Yeah. It seems to me that the hips and the pelvis and the skull would be the first two that I would do, because they are things that can't, you know, that can be reasonably attributed to another species. Like, if the pelvis is human, okay, there we are. If the skull is llama. But it reminds me of this joke, you know, where you have the two horses and they're trying to tell which is which, and they're measuring the tail and they're looking at the teeth. And then somebody says, the white one has a longer tail than the black one. You know, like they, in other words, they didn't recognize that one is white and one is black. If you're trying to understand this by spending lots of time detailing the morphology of one skull versus the other, and you can just break the knot, as you said, cut the knot by going to DNA, go to DNA. The only reason I can imagine why that hasn't been done is because maybe nobody has the money to do it, or maybe somebody with the money, and I'm just saying, like a Gaia, or feels that cutting the knot might interfere with the enterprise of promoting these as being genuine. Does that make sense?
Exactly.
To you?
That's the problem. That there is a financial motive here. Not in your end of it, but in the other end of it. Obviously, they're making a big publicity thing out of it, and I'm sure they're making money. Of course,
and that's why I should say that is why Theirry, if you don't mind me saying this on your show, that's why he cut ties with Gaia and Jaime. He said these people are not interested in truth per se. Maybe incidentally they are, but they are corporations, and they're trying to make some money. And that's not where we want to go with this. We do not need motivation.
So now at this point, whatever they're doing is one thing, and they're not doing much because they don't have an interest in finding out that these things are fakes. Although I have to tell you, I would not be surprised if there's something about the smaller ones that is extremely strange, because they may be fake and real at the same time. And here's what I mean. And I'm not the only close encounter witness who has seen this. I have seen a drawer filled with these little bodies that became animated and came out of it like they were alive. And they were somehow, I know it's wild. I mean, William doesn't follow the abduction thing, so he doesn't know a lot of what we all know. But a lot of my viewers and listeners are thinking about this right now. What if these are constructions that could be used and somehow animated?
I have thought about that. It's a very strange thing. You know what? I think a little bit about the legends of the golem, which you might be familiar with.
Of course, yes. Tell us a little bit about that.
Well, I'm Jewish, but I'm not very observant, which is why I'm speaking to you on this high holy day. But in Jewish tradition, there are stories of rabbis who were also deeply involved with Kabbalah and magic and things that are not entirely unfamiliar to you, and who constructed beings out of material. I don't know exactly what they used. I think mud and organic material. And they animated these things by putting symbols on them, names of God or something like this. And generally that did not end well. But these endeavors are very much a part of Jewish lore. And I think there are analogies in other cultures. It's very wacky, and it's not the first thing that anybody would jump to as an explanation for these things. But it did cross my mind that, I mean, there are other aspects to this story, Whitley. Other people I've spoken to and things that I've heard, which reinforce the idea that if these are not actual beings, there are actual beings that look very much like these ones.
Like that.
Because and I've spoken.
There were little people. There were little grays, and there were little blue men too that didn't look anything like the mummies involved in my experience. And the little grays I can see where you could reconstruct one on one of those skeletons, one of those mummies.
Okay, I think you would acknowledge that this is pretty far-fetched thinking, but I think we both we've both seen enough stuff in our lives to not rule anything entirely out. But getting back to more scientific view, I think the first thing to do before any of that speculation is to cut to the chase. And we need people who are not trying to prolong this mystery for profit.
Right.
We need people who want to get to it. And that's where I am really trying. I mean, Theirry he would love to find out what this is all about. But this is not the center of his world. He is doing very important archaeological and anthropological research in the Amazon. And he can't put his money to this. He doesn't have $10,000, $20,000 to get DNA tests. He would like to. And he is looking for somebody. I'm hoping that I, in my small contribution, can maybe link up Theirry with some patron who will say, $20,000, sure. If that will solve this issue or some aspect of this issue once and for all, here it is. And I think we're on the verge of that. And that's what I'm excited about. And all this has happened in the last few days. And
it's a remarkable time. And it has been fascinating to talk to you about it. I have one last question. And am I right about thinking that there was one of these mummies that was female and had a uterus with eggs in it?
Well, uterus or not, that's one of, yeah, okay. If I could address this, Whitley, there are many very strange things about these mummies which don't comport with the notion of some workshop in modern Peru where people are sticking these things together. First of all, if you think about it, if these are made from modified ancient llama skulls, and They have to be ancient for certain bones to have deteriorated enough for them to be able to be used in this manner. If you used a modern llama skull, for example, there is a ridge on the top of the skull. That ridge is not there, and it hasn't been cut off. It has degraded, apparently. That's the only explanation that these scientists could give as to why these don't have that ridge.
Boy, we got to get DNA testing.
Yeah, exactly.
Weird thing. Boy, go ahead.
Yeah. I lost my thought for a second.
You're talking about the ridges.
Right. Okay, but let us say that the rest of the bones are from human infants. That would entail the discovery by some people with malintent or the intent to deceive, to make money, which is pretty universal. The intent to make money is universal. The intent to deceive, not so much. But if they would have had to discover a plethora, a mine of mummified human infants to get all those bones to make at least 25 bodies. Do you follow me?
Yeah.
And then they would have had to take these bodies, hack them apart, and put them together to look like these mummies.
In the context of ordinary archaeology, are mummies found often in the area of Nazca that are the same age as these? Human mummies that we know are human.
I know that I've heard that when you walk in the Nazca Desert, you do come upon mummies quite frequently.
Okay, so that's not a... So that could be...
They made a lot of mummies. Most of them are not in pristine condition, right?
Understandably, if they're in the Nazca Desert.
But going through the desert and finding a finger bone here and a finger bone there, I don't know. There's that part of it. But again, that's not beyond the capability of people. Let's get to the metallurgy aspect of this. There are what I call accoutrements on some of these mummies, but not all of them.
The little ones are the big ones.
The little ones. I don't think there have been any metal parts found on the big ones. I'm quite sure that's negative.
Okay.
On the small ones, on some of these mummies, there are many metal plates, and that's as much as I want to say about that. But there are metal pieces that are adhered in some way to the bodies. Most famously on Josephina, the one that has eggs in it, and I'll get to that in a moment, there's a metal breastplate that looks something like a bikini top on the chest of Josephina, of this mummy. When they analyzed this, they found that was made out of metal that corresponded to the alloys that were made in ancient Incan times, 1,000 years ago.
Now, osmium?
Well, okay, I'm taking in stages. First of all, there's that, and all of the metal that they found are made from these alloys which were used in ancient times. Now, there are two possibilities. If it's a modern fake, there are two possibilities. They found a bunch of ancient metal objects, and they fashioned them to be these accoutrements. Now, they didn't have to have accoutrements on these mummies in order for the mummies to be extraordinary. Most of the mummies have no accoutrements. So why would they select a few of them to put these plates on and fashion them out of ancient metal, right? In the process, destroying artifacts that are made of metal and presumably have some archaeological and commercial value. The other possibility is that they forged this alloy, if that's the word to use, that they actually created this alloy using bronze and copper and silver. That's a tremendous amount of work to make something that's not necessary. You follow me? They're not selling the ones with metal plates for more money than they're selling the ones with no metal plates. right? Insofar as Mario is concerned, he's not. I happen to know that he was not offering these things. Oh, this one has metal plates, so it's more money. But that would be a tremendous amount more effort for a faker or a hoaxer to do, if you follow my logic on that.
Yeah.
Now, it gets stranger than that. In at least one of these accoutrements, I believe it was the breastplate on Josephine, and we are talking about, among all of these mummies, dozens of metal pieces that are put in various places on the bodies. The breastplate, they did a spectrographic analysis of the metal, and they had a spike which indicated the presence of osmium. Now, I had never heard of osmium. My brother, who's a physicist, had never heard of osmium. It's just not a topic of conversation because it's extraordinarily rare. Osmium is heavier than uranium, twice as heavy as lead. If you can imagine holding a fishing weight, if you had a piece of osmium that size and dimension, it would be twice as heavy as that. That's extraordinary. And it is far more valuable than platinum. So then you ask yourself, okay, you're a hoaxer in a workshop in Nazca. You're making fake mummies to sell to Russian, pardon me, let me get rid of that phone call. One second. Okay, sorry. If you're a hoaxer, why in the world are you going to add the most precious metal in the world to a mummy that you're charging not a penny more for than the one that has no metal on it at all? You follow me? It doesn't make sense logically to me. And that gives me
sense.
That gives me the, I mean, now maybe my facts are wrong, but the osmium is unambiguously in the spectrographic.
I know a lot about spectrography, and when you say a spike, it's osmium. There's no question about that. We used to do many spectrographic analyses of the implants, and
right,
you know, when you see one of those big spikes, you know you've got
that's
being very positively detected.
Right. Now, are there nodules? I'm not certain of this. Theirry could answer this question. Are there nodules, like little specks of osmium, you know, around? That's the notion I got. Or is the osmium mixed in at an alloy level to the entire thing? My sense was that there were pockets, if you will, and they may be very, very tiny.
Mm-hmm.
But osmium nonetheless. And, you know, you can order bits of osmium over the internet, but a tiny piece is going to cost you $400. I mean, like, the size of a pinhead is going to be about $100. So you have to wonder. To me, these are the aspects of this case that make it much more mysterious than simply there's a workshop and they're grabbing some infant bones and some llama bones and sticking them together and trying to sell them. The other thing, Whitley, another thing that I've thought about is, let's say you are a hoaxer trying to make some money from this scam. Who are you going to sell these to? Well, somebody with money. A, they can't be taken out of Peru legally. And if you get caught trying to ship one of these things out of Peru, you go to jail. And nobody wants to do that. And that really limits your ability to sell these things. The fact that the person who's buying it is now going to have a warrant in Peru, and the person who actually sends it out of Peru, it could be put in jail. They don't joke around.
And then, they don't. No, when it comes to this kind of artifact, these governments, Peru and the others in South America, they fight all the time to avoid having their artifacts removed. And if you're going to remove an artifact like this, then you'd better not show it publicly, because if you do that, you're going to get into trouble.
Which is what Jaime just did, which is a mystery to you and me, but there you are.
Well, as I said, I have a feeling those aren't real. Might be copies made to look like the real deal.
which would be awfully ballsy of Jaime to take copies.
Yeah, but you know, he could explain it by saying, well, we couldn't take the real ones out of Peru, so we created these, but they look exactly the same, and my story is still true.
He said these are the real deal. So anyway, but that's
well, between that's him. True. He did. He said it straight out.
Yeah.
Well, we'll have to see. Maybe he got permission to take them out.
Maybe he did. But let's just spool that out a little bit more. Let's say you're this hoaxer. You make these things. You find a client. Now, maybe you could sell the thing for $10,000, $15,000 in Peru, which I have good knowledge. That's what they're being sold for, which isn't that much. But now you add the complication of having to avoid going to jail by secretly spiriting them out to Russia or Saudi Arabia or California or wherever some rich guy wants. You're going to add a hefty premium, right? I mean, if you buy cocaine in the middle of in the jungle of, I'm not speaking from personal experience, but if you buy cocaine from a cocaine maker in the Amazon jungle, it's going to be one price. If you have to buy it on the streets of California, where it is highly illegal and has to have gone, then you're going to spend 100 or 1,000 times more for that, right? Oh. Because it's illegal and you are in danger of going to jail if you have it or if you're caught trying to transport it. So let's say these things are 10 times increased by their being snuck out of Peru to go into the collection of an oligarch in Moscow. So let's say that guy just spent $100,000 on one of these things. Then this guy finds out they're fake. He finds out it's a llama skull. He sends Igor, his his helper, the guy who snuck it out, back to Peru, and Igor breaks the legs of the person who sent it to him, because it was represented. Do you see what I'm saying?
Yeah, I understand.
They don't pay these people. It's so who in the world are they trying to sell these to?
And yet, every single one we have comes from this mysterious grave robber, Mario, who won't tell anyone where he finds them.
That's a big part of it. And
yeah, that's a big problem. That's been the main stumbling block for me. With the people I've been trying, the scientists I've been trying to attract, because I understand I've made the provenance argument with them, but the provenance actually doesn't matter.
But
the problem is, from their standpoint, it does matter to the institutions that they are associated with. And to the financing entities that give them grants.
So that's why we're not going.
And there's no way to get around that.
Well, there is, and it's called media and TV and entertainment. And some of these people, let's say a legitimately wealthy person who is legitimately interested in this, a Bigelow, a Brandon Fugel, any number of billionaires who are interested in this. This is pocket change, chump change for them.
Yeah.
If they are willing, and this is where this TV producer comes in, who I'm speaking to, I'm going to call right after we speak, or he's going to call me. If he can interest somebody who could be anonymous or not to, you know, take some material legally brought out of Peru from the skull, deep within the bone of one of these beings, llama skull or not, find out what it is. If that tests as something wildly exotic, which just happens to look like a llama skull, then you've got the discovery of the ages. If it's a llama skull, okay, that part is settled. Now let's get to who made them and why and how and when. Right? Who, why, how, and when?
Yeah, exactly. Well, it's such an incredible case. A completely brain-bending case, and I think it's time you've given us an excellent overview of the actual situation and all of its ambiguity and all of its wonder and all of its promise, and there's great promise here, clearly, but that promise has not been fulfilled yet, and it has to be fulfilled quite differently from what's been done so far publicly. And
you know, I'm sorry.
Go ahead.
I just want to say, you know, you and I, you more than me, but I've been fascinated by this topic and looking for answers since I was a kid. And I've had my experiences of my own, and it's a huge part of my life looking into this. Until 3 years ago, or 2017, and more so in the last few months with David Grush and all that, in the 7 years that I've been following this case, or 7 or 8 years I've been following this case, I felt that this might be the key to unlocking this whole thing. If we have found alien bodies and they can be proved to be such, then the answer to we are not alone is available to anybody who wants to look. That urgency now has dissipated a little bit because things are moving in the disclosure world. And I'm glad of that. It takes pressure off of this case. And I just want to say, if it turns out that there is indeed a clever hoaxer who has a sense of humor or a sense of irony and is making all these crazy things with osmium and just to, pardon me, screw with our brains, then God bless him. We'll find that out.
Yeah.
And we'll find out that these are modern fakes, and that's the end of the story. And
well, I'd certainly like to meet him because it'd be a terribly interesting person for sure.
Exactly right. And it doesn't torpedo the search for the answers of whether we're, you know, and so yeah. I feel liberated in that sense. Like I can look at this thing with an open mind and saying they're real, they're fake, they're modern fakes, they're ancient fakes, they're anomalous fakes, there's something very bizarre behind them, they're golems, they're whatever they might be. And I'm happy to say that I can look at that with an objective mind with no preconceived agenda. Does that make sense?
Yeah, it makes sense. I think you've struggled emotionally with this for a long time and come to a very good place in the sense that you're now really focused on let's get to the bottom of this. And there's enough physical material in this case to say with some assurance that we can do that if we get the right people behind us. So
seems to me we're on the verge of that. And to tell you the truth, even Theirry does not know about these new connections that I've made. I'm going to inform him this evening. And
oh,
they
good.
May pan out, they may not pan out, but they're promising. And I think if this doesn't come about, there are similar opportunities to get to the bottom.
Exactly. Well, thank you so much for spending some time with us on this Dreamland special. And those of you who aren't subscribers, hey, you know, he wouldn't be here and I would not be here if it wasn't for our subscribers. So I would both urge those of you who do not subscribe on unknowncountry.com to the show and thank those of you who do because you make this possible. Thank you very much for being with us, William. It's a pleasure.
Thanks, Willie. Always a pleasure. See you soon.
You've been listening to Dreamland. Be sure to tune in again next week. Dreamland is brought to you by unknowncountry.com and its family of subscribers. Our theme music is The O of Pleasure by Ray Lynch. Unknown Country was founded by Ann Strieber. Our news editor is Matthew Frizzell. Our coordinator is Amy Safrankova. Whitley Strieber is your Dreamland host. And I'm your announcer, Ted Alexander.